All right. Now, this next person is, well, nice motorcycle?
It's a Harley.
Okay. I don't mean to interrupt, but I was wondering if I could talk to you.
About what?
Your MS.
I don't need to talk about that.
I understand, but people might want to hear your story.
What do they need to hear? That I started to get this incredible pain in my feet, a pain I hadn't felt since I was in the Marines, and marched 25 miles a day with a pack on my back. It felt like hell, and it was a numbing pain. And in about 15 days, it crept all over my body. Why don't you put yourself in this position? You wake up and your feet are asleep. That first step you take, that first numbing, prickling pain sensation. When you take that first step and your feet are still waking up and you're going to the bathroom or getting motivated for the day, except for that pain does not go away. You wake up and that pain is all over your body. And that's that way for 5 months. One continuous pain. I was taking drugs to try to sleep. These drugs would probably knock any normal human being out for 8 to 10 hours. Well, they were knocking me out for 4, and I was that way for 5 months. Just utter, utter pain.
That's one thing we could talk about. Perhaps you could talk about how it affected you in the Marine Corps?
No, at the time of the onset of the disease, I was out of the military. But they can trace it all the way back. You know, the physical part about being a Marine is probably what helped me the most. Because it forced my brain, my muscles, and my body to rewire its entire system because of all that pain and all that misery I was in. I thought everybody else was the same way. Well, they weren't. I was that way for 7 years. And I come to find out so many years later the cause of why I was in sick hall because of headaches. I was hospitalized once because of headaches and unexplained pain in my right side. You know, there's no tissue damage, no obvious signs of swelling. It's only nerves. It's a neurological pain. When it moved through my entire body, they took 16 blood draws, 5 MRIs, and a spinal tap. And then they tell me I have multiple sclerosis.
Well, we could talk about your reaction to that. Was it a surprise?
I already knew what MS did because my sister had it. I basically had to watch her waste away. When I took her to the doctor, she weighed in at 87 pounds. It looked like she came out of a concentration camp. And I think that's the worst I've ever seen it. Thank God I got her to the doctor when I did, because they were able to get her weight back up. But now, she can't live by herself, she can't take care of herself, and I promised myself I will not get that way, especially looking at that VA-type nursing home. Sorry, the VA does a lot for you, but they ain't gonna take care of you in no nursing home. So I've been keeping pretty physically active, you know, jumping out of airplanes, riding my Harley, and praying to the Almighty that I get another day with air in my lungs. A good quality of life, but that quality is fleeting. Because all you can do with this disease is not win. There's only loss, because there's a loss of your cognitive skills, a loss of your mobility, a loss of your freedom, a loss of your self-esteem. There is only loss, and that's why I don't want to talk about it.
Maybe there is something you want to talk about.
I was a heavy machine operator at the paper mill. I'd operate clamp trucks. I'd move 1 to 2 to 3 ton rolls of paper. I moved 40 tons of rolls a day, worked 12 hours a day. When I got sick, they moved me to management. And then, after a while, they moved me back to the union. They'd never heard of someone going from the union, going to management, and then sending them back to the union. Of course, they sent me because the benefits were better, because they had long and short-term disability. They sent me for a lot of things. But as soon as I was back and they knew I had MS, they were watching me doubly. They were always on my back. Are you operating all right? Are you sure you can handle that? You know what? I dropped a roll from 6 feet in the air. and they were all over me because I have MS. Well, before that, I dropped a roll 30 feet in the air, and they didn't say anything. That's a sting. It's a nasty sting. It's a nasty sting when they go. Are you sure you can operate this all right? You know, that's like 16 tons rolling down the highway at 20 miles an hour. And if you hit someone, or you lose control, or lose your mobility, you're gonna kill people. I guess I've never felt the real cutdowns. The real cutdowns, you know, it's not really cutdowns. It's more like a subliminal type of discrimination. And that's why I don't want to talk about it.
Okay, I see your point. I won't push you to talk about it. Thanks for listening to me, though. I'll let you get back to your Harley. Wow, what a story. Imagine if you wanted to talk about it. Okay, let's try Josalynn again. Is everything okay?
You can come in now. I'm still.
Okay. So, does that happen to you a lot?
The seizures? Well, just recently, I started having some. Other than annoying, I kind of find them funny. For instance, my last MRI, it was kind of, well, humorous, because I ended up having a full-blown seizure while it was in the MRI machine. And they didn't know it at first, and all I could hear them say was, "You need to lay perfectly still." And they heard me thumping around in there, but I couldn't do anything. And then when they finally realized I was having a seizure, the MRI machine broke. And the thing that I was laying on that comes in and out, that slides in and out by pushing a button, it wasn't working. So I laid in there and until they rebooted it. I was in there for almost 2 hours.
So how long have you had MS?
I was diagnosed in 2008, May of 2008. I was working two jobs and was working on my LPN degree in college. And I was actually working at my second part-time job at Pizza Hut on a Friday night when I just didn't feel right. I had been there all day. I started to get lightheaded and dizzy and knew I was either going to faint or get sick. So I went and I sat down for a few minutes. Well, after a few minutes of sitting down, I went to get back up and couldn't feel the right side, my right leg, or my right arm at all. So I called my mom and asked her to come get me, and I told my boss I was going to the hospital, and she told me I was fine to go back to work. Well, she thought I was just trying to get out of work on a Friday night. So I went anyways, and after about probably a half hour, 45 minutes of being there, they did all these tests, and they told me I had a stroke. And then the neurologist kept me, and the next day they did a spinal tap, and that's when I was diagnosed with MS.
And now you can't work?
Well, not for money. I do have three kids and a home to take care of, along with a husband.
Wow, is there anything else?
Oh, well, let's see. Like right now, I can get around fine, but there's days when I can't even force myself to get out of bed. So I always have to call somebody to help me with my kids. And it's annoying because I don't know when it's gonna happen. That's the only thing that worries me is I never know when it's gonna happen. Like the other night, I was cooking supper for my kids and I fell in the kitchen and I couldn't, like I was mad, but I went to get back up and I couldn't. And so my daughter ran outside to get my husband, and he came in, and first thing he did was laugh, of course, made fun of me. And he asked me if I was gonna get up or if I was just gonna lay on the floor all night. So I told him I was gonna get up, and then he proceeded to ask me if I thought the chairs were too good for me, and so I decided to sit on the floor. Well, of course, I threw my shoe at him. And after I did that, he looked at me and goes, "Well, I'm gonna make you get up on your own now because I'm interested to see how you do it."
So has having this like dark sense of humor helped then, or?
Most definitely, most definitely. It's just kind of, when I first got diagnosed, I was really mad because it took away, for me, it it felt like it was taking away my independence. Because it took a while, a lot of therapy, and all summer to get used to asking for help and needing help there and this and that and everything else that was going on with three small kids. So I quit being mad about it and started kind of making fun about it. But I kind of have to be careful a lot of times because of who I'm around, because if people don't know me, it kind of makes them mad that I just crack jokes about it.
Well, what do you mean exactly?
Well, for instance, a while back I was at an MS conference with my mom, and I got up to go to the bathroom. And as I was going into the bathroom, there was an older lady that was in one of those motorized scooters that was coming out to my left. And there was another lady in front of me that was going in, also on a scooter. Well, the lady to my left started to fall off. Like, her leg started to slide off. And assuming that she didn't have a whole lot of strength in her legs, the reason being in the scooter, the lady in front of me pointed out that she was falling and asked if there was anything she could do, and the lady to my left that was falling just kind of looked at her and goes, "What the hell are you going to do? You're in one of these stupid things too," which I had to force myself not to laugh because I didn't know how both of them would react to that. So, you know, I asked if there was anything to do that I could help with, and she just looked at me and her exact words were, "Nope. I'm just gonna fall and lay down till somebody finds me and helps me up." And so with nurses training and CNA training and all that, I knew how to help her. So I got her back on her scooter, and she thanked me and asked me if the reason I was there is because that somebody in my family had MS. And I explained to her that I did, and she just kind of smiled and thanked me again and drove off.
Well, it's amazing that you're able to keep, like, your humor throughout all of this. It's just amazing. How do you do it?
Well, like I said, I got over being mad and finally realized the blessings that came from my diagnosis. Not being able to work or anything right now, I stay at home with my kids. I don't have to send them to daycare. And my youngest kid being two, I was able to see his first steps and hear him say his first words. And that's something that I miss out on with my 6-year-old and my 3-year-old, because I was always working or in class, or they were always at daycare with one of my family members. So it's actually brought my family closer together.
Well, thank you for sharing your story with us. It's been a real help with my paper.
Always happy to help. You better get a move on, or in my household, my husband anyways, you better shake a leg.
Thank you so much. Well, now I have my paper, I just don't know how to conclude it. How am I gonna do that?
We do have a conclusion. We have a conclusion.
Oh, yay. Let me hear it.
Yeah, and that is part of the conclusion. Our conclusion is that although we have been on the stage today, that we would not be here without you. And we love you. We thank you so much. Yes, please join. Daniel, please join us too. Because we all have something really to share with you. And these marvelous Lincoln High School students, theater actors, amazingly great, are here, and they're in their acting mode, they're saying thank you, but they are also representing some of us whose vignettes you heard tonight. And these people also have this to say. We could not have this fulfillment that is the sharing without your support. We would not have this voice. We did have a lot of funny stories when we were around the table, and we enjoyed those. But Would you say that this is developed into something that's much more than that?
Yes.
And we have already heard about what we consider to be miracles. And we have to say that we wouldn't do it without you. You're the people who day to day help us. It seems like maybe small things, but they make a huge difference to us. But you are the people who do huge things for us. We know it. You are our families, you are our friends, you're our colleagues, you're our supporters. And maybe the conclusion of all of this, the whole point of it, is for you to really hear how much we thank you. We thank you from the bottoms of our hearts. We love you very much. The spotlight was here tonight. In our hearts and in our lives, you are the spotlight. You are the people. We also know that you do things that we don't even know that you do. Thanks. We also know that you do things that we will never find out that you do. Your love is strong enough to cause a dramatic performance. Thank you very much.